opposing the child at this stage, there's a phallic stage, has not at all properly negotiated or properly resolved the particular conflict called Oedipus complex. That's why he calls it Oedipus complex. Then what happens, or what will happen, is he may be having fixation, unconscious, remember, unconscious fixation towards his mother. So that is why he may not be appropriate for heterosexual roles. He may be aversive of, he may avoid heterosexual relations. He may face various marital problems in future also. He may be having certain homosexual inclinations also, unconscious, hidden homosexual inclinations, maybe. He has to be treated, for which technique of psychoanalysis enters into the scenario. So this is with reference to the boy, that is Oedipus complex. What about the counterpart of this Oedipus complex for the girl? Male Oedipus complex and the female Oedipus complex. But later on, he just renamed it as Electra complex, the feminine counterpart of Oedipus complex. It takes up a roundabout or circuitous and a very, very complicated route in the girl. The analogous part in the girl of the penis is the clitoris. So that is, the girl now indulges in masturbating the clitoral organ or clitoris. That means the clitoral masturbation leads to the understanding in the girl that she will be rewarded with the organ being possessed by the boy. That is why Freud is being criticized by feminists also. What he introduces, the term penis envy. That means, for the boy, castration anxiety always is the turning point or the springboard from where will emerge the positive feeling or positive attitude shown towards the father by way of identifying himself with the father. And by way of withdrawing the libidinal energy shown towards the mother, gradually he will start showing affection and sense of affiliation, etc., etc., towards the mother. That is positive, that is repressed. That is, the particular thought process has been repressed, that is, incestual feeling has been repressed, okay? And then sublimation also, yes, smooth. It's over. That is, castration anxiety is always the turning point in the boy. But since in the girl, she is always castrated, already has been castrated. She doesn't possess the organ being possessed by the boy. So that is why, for Freud, she envies the organ being possessed by the boy. That is why he introduces the term, as I told you, penis envy. She envies. That means she always needs that organ and she hopes to get the organ through the father. She is longing for the organ, literally, again. She is longing for the organ and she just, first of all, she imagines that this organ will be given by the mother first, because mother is a center, even not only for the boy, even for the girl also. She is a center not only for the pleasure and satisfaction also, biological as well as social, belongingness, there's a debt. So that is why she is always longing for the organ, and this organ she hopes to get it from the mother. Okay. Soon after the realization that even the mother also doesn't possess the organ, automatically what will happen is, she starts hating the mother. Just opposite happens here. Try to understand the logic. That is, the boy starts hating the father, but in this case, in the girl starts hating gradually the mother. This particular tendency of hatred has to be repressed later on by way of identifying herself with the mother and withdrawing the sexual energy or the libidinal energy centered around the father. That means she has been longing for the particular organ possessed by the father. She understands pretty well, since the organ is being possessed by the father, that organ has to be given by the father. So this wish to possess the particular organ male organ will not be satisfied or cannot be satisfied. That is biological inevitability. It is unavoidable, exactly. So what happens is, during this juncture, that is gradually, the hatred shown towards the mother will have to be converted, automatically it is being converted into constructive channel by way of identifying herself with the mother. The incestual wish so far shown by the girl towards the father will have to be converted by way of showing affection and affiliation towards the father now. So that is what we call sublimation according to Freud. So repression and sublimation always will go hand in hand. That means these two aspects pave the way for the development of personality, that is healthy personality in future. Supposing this particular stage has not been well negotiated or the conflict has not been resolved in the girl means, it will be having its own complication in future development also. That means she may be having various complications, especially that is electro complex, that is unconsciously hidden electro complex, whenever she just happens to meet the opposite sex. That is, heterosexual relations may not be proper, and that means she may be aversive of indulging in natural sexual life. Well, that is one more agency is awaiting an opportune moment to come out or to evolve, according to Freud, during this stage. That is, the pending aspect, it is the superego. So far I have introduced id and ego, and now comes one more super agency for Freud, that is superego. So this, what exactly superego means? It is nothing but, simply put, conscience or guilt feeling, that's all. The do's and don'ts, the moral principles have to be followed by the individual, because the individual has to evolve from the biological existence. So that is why, according to reality principle, he has to balance through the ego, and this ego now steers the personality according to principles operating in the society. Supposing whenever those principles, those moral aspects, those moral boundaries are crossed by the individual means, the individual feels guilty. That is guilt feeling. This guilt feeling or anxiety, moral anxiety also it is called. So this moral anxiety or moral fear, literally put or crudely put, is known as superego for Freud. The Ten Commandments, we can remember. Ten Commandments given by the God Jehovah to Moses. So these Ten Commandments resemble for Freud the superego. It's an age-old phenomenon, remember. Again emphasize, that is Freudian emphasis is, that is from id, from the id impulses, always will emerge ego, as well as the superego. Since during the resolution of the Oedipus and electro complexes, respectively in the boy and the girl, the superego evolves and the superego starts looking after the morality of the individual. Now these three aspects come in, three structures of personality for Freud, that is id, ego and superego. So hence, for Freud, superego is the legal heir of Oedipus complex. Try to understand the logic again. Well put by Freud. It is a descendant, it is offspring of the resolution of Oedipus complex. Inappropriate resolution of Oedipus complex means definitely inappropriate guilt feelings. Most of the times, the criminals don't have guilt feelings. That is psychopathy. In psychology we call psychopath or a sociopath. The sociopath or the criminal, simply put, doesn't feel any guilt feeling, doesn't feel any remorse, he doesn't feel sad about the things. It's a routine affair, that's all for him. In this case, in this criminal, this superego is not at all proper. That is, the evolution of superego has not been proper according to Freud. So these three stages of psychosexual development have proceeded. And in between the stages, one more interim period, so to say, now comes. It's not a stage, it's a misnomer. Even in the so-called seasoned textbooks also still carry the term stage. It is not a stage. I'm now going to refer to it. This period is latency period, he calls. He has crossed 6 years. The individual has crossed 6 years. Now, between 6 and approximately 12 years of age, the psychosexual development is not that much active as it was before, that's all. That means the sexual interest, that is the infantile sexuality, is being kept in abeyance. The libidinal energy is being suspended. That doesn't mean it is inactive, it is dormant, that's all. That is why he prefers the term to call it latency period. Latency means it is a lull period, that's all. It is there. So during this period, the child or the individual, not only a child, an individual, now shows immense interest in studies, learning, social skills. That is why this is the stage apt for schooling. Usually in psychology, we call him a preschooler, roughly. So this latency period, supposing has been crossed by the child, means now the individual is ready to enter the next period on the stage now again. This stage, according to Freud, is nothing but genital stage. So genital stage means healthy heterosexual relations he has to undergo, he has to enter. And this, how well he is capable of encountering the healthy sexual relations or heterosexual relations, beyond doubt, everything is well dependent on how well he has been negotiating the previous stages, remember. So that is why we can just refer to the couplets, the golden couplets put forth by T.S. Eliot, the mystical poet he was. What he said was these lines: the time past and present will always be in time future. Try to grasp it. The time past and present will always be in time future. That means the childhood experiences, that is the destiny, always prevails over the present. That means how well the individual is at present always has been well conditioned by the childhood experiences before. History continues. Even for healthy sexual relations, the individual is highly dependent on the healthy negotiations, in the successful negotiations in the preceding stages of psychosexual development for Freud. So along with these psychosexual developmental stages, always travels the mind. That is why it is called psychosexual, as I introduced the term well in advance. So for our convenience, again, we can just compartmentalize the structures of the mind, or the components of the mind, or the consciousness. This is a crude term, consciousness, anyway. He just classifies the mind into three compartments. Again, for our convenience, again, don't compartmentalize anything. It's equally dangerous also. That is, first is conscious. The mind is conscious. Conscious is, well, it is self-explanatory. That is, we are aware of our existence, that is conscious. Well, we are conscious of things. Okay, right. And another layer comes in for Freud, that is pre-conscious. Again and again, I just try to emphasize, you may come across in almost all textbooks or any pulp literature also, usually, the term subconscious mind or subconscious mind, something like that, or subconscious. He was against the usage of the word subconscious, for your kind reference, I'm saying. He never encouraged the usage of the word subconsciousness or subconscious mind. Instead, he preferred the term only pre-conscious. It's neither purely conscious nor completely unconscious. That is why it is in between, pre-conscious. This pre-conscious state is nothing but, if you put up certain efforts, you can recollect certain past memories. At times, certain reflections, certain feelings, certain aspects. You can recollect your past if you strain much. That is the layer known as preconscious. And what about the other one, that is unconscious? Unconscious, it is again self-explanatory. Unconscious means it is purely unconscious. It is more or less hidden. That is why he gives us an analogy of the tip of the iceberg. The iceberg, the bulky volume of the iceberg, is deeply hidden. We know the fate of the Titanic ship. It dashed against the iceberg, and then we know the history again, the fate. So similarly, that is, the ship of personality is always is having most of the part hidden behind, our hidden agenda of the personality. So this hidden means, don't think it is completely out of sight again. Unconscious, once it was, should have been conscious. That is, time past and present will always be in time future. Again, the same couplet I am repeating to understand the significance of unconscious. Childhood memories, childhood experiences of the past go on influencing in the substratum of unconscious. That is, this unconscious portion always is having the hidden memories, emotions, recollections, feelings, etc., etc., of our past life. That is, individual's past life. Not past life means extra life, not like that. That is, previous life experiences, childhood experiences, especially again. So these experiences are always hidden. Although they are hidden, they are more active, more viable than it was before. That is, unconscious is having the repressed thought processes. Repression means automatic forgetting. That is complete automatic. It is an automatic process, that's all. Since, remember, just go back to the previous categorization by Freud, there is id, ego and superego. There is id is coming beneath, that is instinctual energy, that's all. It is boiling, simmering with energy always. Then these id impulses have to be contained, have to be appropriately modified, converted according to societal norms. So that is possible only because of the agency known as ego, as we know well. And what about the superego? Superego is again conscience. Conscience abiding citizens we should be. So in that sense, this superego is operating from above and id from below. So more or less, the ego is sandwiched in between. So that is why the ego is always more or less acting as a watchdog-like role. It's the governor of personality. That is why, just again, make it to remember, wherever the id was, there shall always be the ego. Well, then again coming back to the unconsciousness. So this unconscious, as I told you before, since is having the repressed thought processes, repressed means forbidden thought processes, prohibited thought processes, the incestual wishes, once the child, as a child, the individual should have shown towards the parents, that is Oedipus as well as Electra complexes, and hatred, love, etc., etc. So those things are always there, very much alive, remember. Very much alive, but at the same time, they are always alive in the sense, they are awaiting an opportune moment to come out through various socially accepted channels. Socially accepted channels, underline the word. Society is having humpty number of channels. So in the roundabout fashion, or in the symbolic fashions, the unconscious hidden feelings, hidden memories, thought processes, everything will have to be represented appropriately in the constructive way. That is sublimation. Well, and again remember, that is a socially accepted channel in the sense, the basic aspect is religion. Religion paves the way for releasing these unconscious thought processes through rituals. And similarly, wits. That is why in his book, by name, that is he entitled, he gave the title to this book, the psychopathology of everyday life. Slips of the tongue, slips of the pen, and of all the things, the most important one is the constructive channel or socially accepted channel is dreams. So that is why for Freud, dreams are the royal roads to the unconscious. Dreams are always having wish fulfillment. They are always considered to be wish fulfilling in nature. The wishes in conscious existence may not be fulfilled, will be definitely fulfilled symbolically in our dreams. So that is why dreams are always not only the royal roads to the unconscious, but moreover, they are the guardians of sleep. We daily dream, remember. But most of the times, we may not be capable of recollecting those dreams or remembering the dreams, because the ego is having its full-fledged operation through sensor mechanism. The sensor mechanism is highly operative and it sensors, that is the significant component of ego. So the ego always operating through sensor mechanism, and this sensor mechanism is highly responsible for filtering the material of dreams or dream mechanisms. So this dream mechanism is having two important aspects. One is latent and manifest contents, according to Freud. There's a latent means hidden part. Manifest content means the manifested part. In one's dream, supposing the individual dreams, a cat is being mutilated by a rat. It's highly ridiculous, no doubt. So in the wakeful existence, this particular thing may not take place or cannot take place. But in his dream, this particular symbol represents just opposite to the wakeful existence. That means unconscious exactly follows entirely different logic or principle, whereas conscious mind doesn't understand or refuses to understand. So in this dream symbol, two things or two aspects according to Freud, he mentions. One is manifest content and the latent content, as I told you before. Manifest content means the content getting itself manifested, that means represented, the dream symbol. But this manifestation must be having some definitely hidden meaning. What this hidden meaning is, for which we have to unearth through the symbols the unconsciously laden, fossilized feelings or memories in the individual. So in this case, the therapeutic technique comes in. That's application oriented. So during the process of applying the technique of psychoanalysis has evolved a special methodology called, by Freud himself, free association. No doubt he was a seasoned, able hypnotherapist. He was fed up with hypnosis of his days. He evolved his own technique called free association. So what this free association means? This free association aims at unearthing layer by layer, as an archaeologist does, as an excavator, one who is interested in understanding the fossils or the hidden civilizations, the same job the analyst should perform. The hidden memories, the hidden feelings, deeply laden, deeply loaded in the unconscious, has to be brought out gradually. That means the individual or the patient has to be made by the analyst to grasp the meaning or the inner meanings of this particular manifested content. That is the essence of dream analysis. Also, one of the offshoots of free association. During free association, the analyst actually sits at the back of the patient in a couch, and he encourages the patient to go on imagining whatever point or points, anything, whichever aspect comes to his mind, let him imagine. and he is being encouraged by an analyst to spell it out. That is what he calls catharsis. Catharsis is the terminology. It aims at unearthing not only the hidden thought processes, but along with the thought processes, we are having, always should be having feelings. The pent-up feelings must be released out. Understand? There's a safety valve has to be released. No inhibitions, nothing is there. So actually, during the process of free association, the patient is being gradually encouraged to spell out the hidden part of his memories, feelings, emotions, and whatnot. So that is the essence of free association. And during free association, another thing also happens. That means the analyst, there's a main task again of the analyst is gradually bringing the patient to have an insight over his problem. So in this sense, don't think he's being manipulated by the analyst. Usual criticism level against Freud's or Freudian methodology is this one. Don't consider again Freud as a determinist. Unconscious means once it was active, highly conscious, because of or due to various reasons, especially reasons imposed upon the individual by the society, those feelings, those memories, those thought processes, everything beyond doubt has been repressed. So automatically, though those things have been repressed, that doesn't mean they have become completely dormant. They are highly active, fully energized. Again, I'm just emphasizing it. Those processes, that is feelings, including everything, always awaits an opportune moment to come out through socially accepted channels. Supposing in case these channels again are closed, means definitely the individual goes on exaggerating reality, he gets various problems or neurosis, what he calls. So this neurosis is a plural form and neurosis is a singular form. Psychoneurosis, that is what he calls. Psychoneurosis means now we are having psychosomatic medicine. I hope you understand. Psychosomatic medicine means a psychological impact upon the body. Soma means body. Psyche and soma, they interact. Yogic exercises, beyond doubt, proved well in advance in those days. That is why psychosomatic medicine always emphasizes the role of the impacts, especially negative impacts, alas, these negative impacts upon the mind of the individual. So that is why he preferred the term psychoneurosis. Psychoneurosis, during psychoneurosis, that is for unknown causes, reasons are unknown, but still the individual goes on suffering from the symptoms. Paralysis, for instance, paralysis of the limbs. Organically, he is okay. Physiologically, neurologically, everything he is okay. But still, he continues with the problem or symptom. Behind the symptomatology, definitely must be lurking the unconscious hidden aspect component. That is the essence of free association technique. Actually, he just tried to treat, the analyst tries to treat the patient by way of unearthing layer by layer the hidden thought processes. That is very important here. And for which he just takes up various routes, including dream analysis. And one more technique is transference, it is called. Remember, the ego is having umpteen number of defenses. Like our physiological defense mechanism, the ego of the individual always is having, should be having defenses. That is why Freud terms it ego defenses. Supposing the ego is incapable of defending itself means the ego will be offended. That's all. It is an unconscious mechanism. Umpteen number of references he gives. Time won't permit us to just indulge in all those details. One of the primary aspects of the ego defense is unconscious again. It is, remember, unconsciously. That is rationalization, we say. So this rationalization is a famous Aesop's fable. You can correlate the story, the fable. The fox and the vineyard. Since the fox could not reach the bunches of, the grapes, the fox went on with justifying as if those grapes were sour grapes, the story. you know. So it is exactly the ego defense of the fox, that is rationalization. And one more important ego defense also, I will just introduce you, use projection. The famous legendary example, negative example he was none other than Hitler. Hitler went on projecting his own inner weaknesses, his own negative feelings upon the imagined enemies, Jews. That means my own hidden feelings, my own hidden emotions, I go on just projecting upon others, imagined enemies I'm having. That is projection. Reaction formation, another thing. So reaction formation means just opposite of what I'm preaching. I may be preaching celibacy, that is sane marriages, morality, this and that, but to the core, I'm a debauch. I'm a sexual maniac. So that means reaction formation. Reaction formation, that means opposite to what I'm just preaching. I'm having a defense, that's all. Like the displacement, again in dream also, displacement it is. So displacement, that is from the primary target. Supposing, that is in dreams, I'm supposed to always show through symbols, because symbols are accepted. Remember, for every 15 or so minutes, the individual goes on washing his hands with Dettol and antiseptic solution, this and that. This usually is popularly known as OCD, that is obsessive compulsive disorders. In this terminology of, that is abnormal psychology. So that means, this is the symbolic representation, that's a ritual more or less. So this behind the ritual, he always is having or must be having, we can say, anxiety. That is anxiety neurosis. What is anxiety then? So anxiety is nothing but, according to Freudian definition, inadequately discharged libidinal energy leads to anxiety. So inadequately discharged libidinal energy will lead to anxiety. Well, that means the anxiety means for unknown reasons, we say usually, we get fear, phobias. Phobias against dogs, for instance, that is zoophobia. Fear of darkness, scotophobia, they say. Open spaces, fear of open spaces, agoraphobia, this and that. Again, it goes on, the list elaborates. But here, everything is having unconscious meaning. That is why I'm just trying to convince you. So everything beyond doubt, definitely, in one way or other, shows the unconscious meaning, for which the analyst, psychoanalyst, always encourages what it is termed transference. Again, I just introduced the term before. This transference always means, that means the unconscious displacement on the part of the patient towards the analyst. That means, supposing the unconscious hidden complex, say for instance, the individual is having a fixation towards his parent or parental figure, maybe mother or father. Supposing this analyst is a male figure, means naturally, unconsciously, the same feelings once shown towards the parent or parental figure will be revived during the course of analysis, thereby the individual or the patient here goes on displacing or showing, unconsciously showing the same tendencies towards the analyst, that is transference. So Freud always emphasizes the role of transference. So there is the analytic framework. So during transference, that is encouraged transference, he says. That's a technical aspect it is. So during psychoanalytic practice, encourage transference, he always emphasizes. Or showing, unconsciously showing the same tendencies towards the analyst, that is transference. So Freud always emphasizes the role of transference. So there's the analytic framework. So during transference, that is encouraged transference, he says. That's a technical aspect it is. So during psychoanalytic practice, encourage transference, he always emphasizes. And again, guard against counter-transference. That is, counter-transference means from the analyst's side, his unconscious is getting itself drifted towards the patient at times could be possible. Supposing the patient starts crying or sobbing, then the analyst also joins along with the process of sobbing or crying, means the analysis won't flow further or proceed further. So that is the significance of counter transference. That is why Freud always advises the psychoanalyst to undergo, first of all, their own self-analysis. Before starting practice, try to understand your own complexes first. Know thyself of Socrates. See, in this sense, psychoanalysis emphasizes beyond doubt the role of insight. You are making the unconscious conscious to the patient. That is the logic. So in that sense, you are making the individual aware of his own hidden personality. You are creating insight into the patient. So that is the analytic framework. It is having its own practical implication. And similarly, resistance. First of all, the resistance has to be broken. Because during the process of analysis, especially during free association, he may not cooperate in the beginning. That doesn't mean he is not at all interested in analysis. Gradually, during the process of various sessions, session by session, definitely he will start cooperating with the analyst. That means, first of all, try to understand the mechanism of resistance operating well in the unconscious aspect or unconscious layer of the individual. Try to break the unconscious, try to break the resistance operating. Try to understand the ego defenses also of the individual. So these are the practical aspects of psychoanalysis. And what about the other aspect regarding psychoanalysis? So that is, what exactly the primary goal? As I told you, since you are supposed to make the unconscious conscious, during the process of this awareness created by the analyst, automatically, the individual starts working through. That is why it's called working through process. Working through means he always exactly tries to comprehend, understand appropriately his own personality. That is exactly you are creating awareness inside the individual. So in that sense, don't think psychoanalysis is in one way or other directing the patient. Not like that. It's not at all aiming at the patient's goal towards the particular target. Not like that. That means by way of creating awareness, by way of creating insight, the patient here, he who is lying in the couch, is being made to understand his own personality. That means he is being just encouraged to travel towards the past. Okay. So in this sense, psychoanalysis always is definitely creating the conducive atmosphere for the awareness of his own personality and evolution of this personality also. What about the times or schedules? Of course, psychoanalysis is having longest schedules, no doubt. It may take years together. And the various versions, shortcut versions, etc., condensed forms, everything is available nowadays. But anyway, I'm just talking everything about the classical psychoanalysis and classical theory also. And what about the multicultural perspective regarding psychoanalysis? Whether is it applied in various cultures? Suppose you just raise a question, means yes, you can apply it. That means according to cultures, definitely the socialization process differs. We know. That is why New Freudians, that's all. The descendants of Freud. They came and then they went on with their own versions of psychoanalysis. The one among them was Erik Erikson. His student is Sudhir Kakkar, a living psychoanalyst India produced. He's a legendary psychoanalyst, still practicing. He just tries to understand the psychoanalytic aspect from the cultural perspective. So like that is according to cultures, the practices or socialization differs, no doubt. But accordingly, you have to just try to understand and grasp the personality development. So from this sense, you can apply psychoanalysis across cultures. The basic methodology of psychoanalysis is this, as I put forth, everything in a nutshell, that's all. So this is the practice oriented and not that much time consuming also. So various shortest versions, as I told you, are available, and you can just practice it. We can practice according to the cultural norms or cultural aspects, and accordingly you can just evolve your own techniques also. So various techniques nowadays are available. One among them is transactional analysis also, as propagated by Eric Byrne, the famous games people play, or I'm okay, you are okay, the version. And similarly, that is Adler's, Jung, J-U-N-G, must be pronounced not Jung, Jung. So various versions. So that is why straight jacketing. Nowadays, usually that is the psychoanalysts are being advised to just have a comprehensive, integrated, holistic picture of psychoanalysis from various branches. So there is no hard and fast rule now. But the inspiration got from psychoanalysis is always maintain the analytical framework, always maintain dream analysis, always maintain another thing, that is a transference, always try to understand unconscious from the vantage point of view of free association technique, and then try to understand the ego defenses and make the individual aware of his own personality. So this is the essence of, or quintessence also we can say, the quintessence of psychoanalytic practice. And this psychoanalytic practice is having its own offshoots. One among them is, as I told you, that is various versions, and one among them is, the latest one is Object School of Psychoanalysis, developed by Melanie Klein, etc., and Karen Horney's version, and again Margaret Mahler's. All those things also are available, and accordingly, that is, you can just have a clear-cut picture when you just go through the materials, and later on you can come to a conclusive understanding regarding psychoanalysis. Remember, psychoanalysis cannot be criticized and cannot be rejected outright from the emotional point of view only. So try to understand psychoanalysis from the scientific perspective, try to just gauge everything in detail and correlate all those things with remaining concepts also, then only a clear-cut understanding and clear picture of psychoanalysis will emerge. Thank you.